Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is your good friend, Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we are making our first dive into the world of parasympathetics, which will be really important in innervating many of the exocrine glands associated with the head. Now, the parasympathetics are part of the autonomic nervous system, which has also been referred to as its abbreviation, ANS, or more traditionally, the visceral motor system. So parasympathetic and sympathetic fibers, which are also part of the ANS, consist of motor fibers that will innervate visceral tissue such as smooth muscle or glandular tissue. The parasympathetic system, in most general terms, is the calmer partner to the sympathetic system. Sympathetics are often referred to as the fight or flight system. And the parasympathetics are often lovingly referred to as the rest and digest system. So important in terms of homeostatic or energy conserving processes, such as allowing the body to feed. And producing saliva is really important for the eating and digestion processes. So the focus of this video will be to discuss the innervation of the parotid gland, which will include parasympathetic innervation. All right, I gotta clear my throat because we've got some fun stuff to talk about. The glossopharyngeal nerve is back. This nerve is one of the more complex cranial nerves. It has both sensory and motor fibers, so we remember that sensory really important in terms of the pharynx. And it is going to be important in this discussion because it's one of the four cranial nerves that has preganglionic parasympathetics associated with it. So these fibers would be considered visceral efferent fibers, unlike the somatic efferent fibers that will innervate the stylopharyngeus muscle. So, I know this chart seems a little overwhelming right now, and we are going to take each one of these step by step and slowly talk our way through this, and hopefully towards the end you will think, oh, what a delightful chart that tells me all the information I need to know. But first, let's talk about each one of those these steps one by one. So the glossopharyngeal nerve carries preganglionic parasympathetic fibers. Preganglionic parasympathetic, it's hard to say it, but I'm going to do it quite a bit, so I got to get used to it. So the glossopharyngeal nerve carries preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, and this means fibers that have not yet synapsed in a ganglion. And so these, the glossopharyngeal nerve, of course, is going to originate from the brainstem. Now, as I hope you are becoming increasingly aware, the glossopharyngeal nerve is going to exit via the jugular foramen, which you can see right here. And if you're becoming more comfortable with where this is located, this is going to be between the temporal bone and the occipital bones, so distinctly, fairly irregularly shaped. And after exiting the jugular foramen, specific fibers, so those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, are going to start to head for its target, but it's going to take a very complex route. So these preganglionic parasympathetic fibers are going to kind of coalesce and form a nerve referred to as the tympanic nerve. And this tympanic nerve will actually re-enter the skull via the tympanic cannuliculus. Now, I assume you're a little less familiar with this awesomely named tympanic cannuliculus. To be honest, many seasoned anatomists are not as comfortable as where it's located. And it looks like this tiny pinprick right here. I just kind of colored over it just to kind of give you a more cartoonish idea of where it's located. And it's going to be between this carotid canal, the external opening of the carotid canal, and the jugular foramen. And when I say it looks like a pinprick, I really mean it. That tympanic nerve is not a very large nerve at all, so the opening does not need to be very large either. Now, if I were to put my finger on this landmark region right here and kind of flip it over to look on the inside of the cranium, I would be looking at the petrous part of the temporal bone. So, this nerve, this tympanic nerve, as it enters through the tympanic cannuliculus, is heading into the inside of the petrous part of the temporal bone, which includes the middle and inner ears. So the tympanic nerve has made its way into the middle ear. And we'll talk a lot more about the middle ear in our session associated with the ear. But you can kind of see what it would look like in this region. At this point, instead of being one distinct nerve with nerve fibers wrapped up together with connective tissue to form one nerve, the fibers actually begin to spread out for a bit to form a portion of the tympanic plexus, which you can see on the promontory of the middle ear. The promontory, and you can see it over in this region here, the promontory is actually going to be created by the basal part of the cochlea, so it's creating this bump, and so you'll see small nerve fibers sitting right on top of the promontory. It's important to note that the tympanic plexus is not just composed of those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers from the tympanic nerve, but there are also postganglionic sympathetic fibers that form part of this plexus as well. And these sympathetic fibers are postganglionic at this point because they have synapsed in the superior cervical ganglion. Now, after being part of the tympanic plexus for just a short while, those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers will coalesce and join back together to form the lesser petrosal nerve. The lesser petrosal nerve will exit the skull via the foramen ovale. So let's locate that right here. And while we're doing that, think about why we know the foramen ovale. Why have we talked about the foramen ovale already? Something much larger must traverse this foramen to necessitate such a large foramen. And hopefully you recall that the mandibular nerve, or V3, is also going to exit the skull via the foramen ovale. And this geographical relationship between those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers and V3 is important. So, up to this point, have we been talking about pre- or postganglionic parasympathetic fibers? We have been talking about preganglionic. All right, I've said preganglionic probably at least 50 times in this video. So we've been talking preganglionic. So that means we need to get to a ganglion for these preganglionic fibers to synapse. And there just happens to be the correct one just inferior to the foramen ovale. You can see it here and here on the cartoon, very closely associated with the medial portion of V3. And this ganglion is going to be the otic ganglion. The otic ganglion is one of the four peripheral parasympathetic ganglia of the head, so very closely associated with V3, and this is where those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers will synapse. Once those preganglionic fibers synapse, now they are called postganglionic fibers. All right, so after the synapse occurs, they are post or after the ganglion. And these postganglionic parasympathetic fibers need to reach their target organ, which in this case is the parotid gland. And this will happen by hitchhiking with another nerve that is already heading that way. And this nerve is the auriculotemporal nerve. The auriculotemporal nerve is a branch of V3. So remember, that geographic relationship to V3 is going to be important. And the auriculotemporal nerve is an entirely afferent or sensory branch, which will innervate skin of the anterior superior ear, as well as skin around the temporomandibular joint. So think about those structures and where they're located. That skin is very close to the parotid gland, right? So this is going to be a good way to get those postganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the parotid gland. So when stimulated, this can cause saliva secretion from the parotid. All right, so here's that chart again. I hope it doesn't seem as overwhelming, but let's talk some big picture items. The glossopharyngeal nerve is going to be the source of the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, and that nerve branch that kind of joins together those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers are going to be referred to as the tympanic nerve. The tympanic nerve will spread out its fibers to be a component of the tympanic plexus, and then they will join back together to form the lesser petrosal nerve, which will exit the skull through the foramen ovale. So let's stop here for a moment. If I were to ask you which nerve is the source of the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers that innervate the parotid gland, what would your answer be? What is the source of these fibers? It would be the glossopharyngeal nerve, or cranial nerve 9. Now, what if I asked you which nerve allows passage of the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the parotid gland? What would your answer be? I hope your answer would be the auriculotemporal nerve. But it's important to note that the auriculotemporal nerve is not a parasympathetic nerve. It just allows those postganglionic parasympathetic fibers to travel with a larger collection of fibers on its way to its target organ, the parotid gland. All right, so this may seem a bit of an overkill, but I don't want us to move on to any other topics until we get this. So, question, true or false? The parasympathetic fibers that will innervate the parotid gland originate in the auriculotemporal nerve. True or false? And I hope you have landed on that this is false. The parasympathetic fibers that will innervate the parotid gland originate in the glossopharyngeal nerve, or cranial nerve 9. So it is going to be the glossopharyngeal nerve that is the source of the parasympathetic fibers. The postganglionic parasympathetic fibers synapse in the otic ganglion, and then they hitch a ride to the parotid gland via the auriculotemporal nerve. So that is where the auriculotemporal nerve comes into this process. All right, that has been some fun times with parasympathetics. We only have 3 more peripheral parasympathetic ganglia to discuss throughout the course. Thank you for your time and attention in this video, and have a great day.